Blackstone Publishing presents The Book That Made Your World: How the Bible Created the Soul of Western Civilization by Vishal Mangalwadi. This book is read by Peter Lawrence. All charts, diagrams, and photographs that appear in the print edition of this book can be found in the bonus PDF file that accompanies your audiobook CD or download. For the sincerely respected public intellectual, Member of Parliament, and former Minister to the Government of India, Honorable Arun Shuri, whose criticisms of the Bible prompted this inquiry. Foreword. In polite society, the mere mention of the Bible often introduces a certain measure of anxiety. A serious discussion on the Bible can bring outright contempt. Therefore, it is most refreshing to encounter this engaging and informed assessment of the Bible's profound impact on the modern world. The Book That Made Your World, by Vishal Mangalwadi, brings to mind Alexis de Tocqueville's early 19th century classic, Democracy in America. The invaluable insights of an observant French visitor to America are now a must-read for virtually every college student in America. In a somewhat similar vein, Indian scholar, author, and worldwide lecturer, Vishal Mangalwadi offers within these pages a fresh and wide-ranging assessment of the Bible's impact on Western culture. The Book That Made Your World contains the careful investigation and observations of an outsider viewing Western culture from within. What Mangalwadi discovers will surprise many. His book tells the story of the Bible's amazing influence upon the development of modern Western society. It shows why a serious reassessment of the Bible's relevance to contemporary public discourse and education at all levels, public and private, secular and religious, is both urgently needed and much to be desired. A culture can barely begin, let alone sustain, any serious intergenerational attempt to comprehend, interpret, and respond to the riddles of life and the universe unless it has some reasonably comprehensive worldview. In The Closing of the American Mind, Alan Bloom, a Jewish professor, acknowledged that it was the Bible that gave critical impetus to and sustained the West's intellectual endeavor of examining all great ideas, be they true or false. Bloom wrote, "In the United States, practically speaking, the Bible was the only common culture, one that united the simple and the sophisticated, rich and poor, young and old. And, as the very model for a vision of the order of the whole of things, as well as the key to the rest of Western art, the greatest works of which were in one way or another responsive to the Bible, provided access to the seriousness of books. With its gradual and inevitable disappearance, the very idea of such a total book is disappearing, and fathers and mothers have lost the idea that the highest aspiration they might have for their children is for them to be wise, as priests, prophets, or philosophers are wise. Specialized competence and success are all that they can imagine. Contrary to what is commonly thought, without the book, even the idea of the whole is lost." Mangalwadi underscores the fact that it was the Western Church that gave birth to the university in its determined and passionate effort to pursue truth. Following in the train of the great universities of Bologna, Paris, Oxford, and Cambridge, America's first institution of higher education, Harvard, was founded upon the motto Veritas, truth. Over the course of the last century, however, the motto has been stripped of all meaning. Leading thinkers within the academy have succeeded in persuading many that truth, as such, is largely a function of social convention. The reigning climate of pessimism about our ability to truly know anything significant was most powerfully articulated by the late Richard Rorty, arguably one of the most influential American thinkers of the last 40 years. In What's the Use of Truth, Rorty contends that there is no privileged position or any kind of authority that can provide a rationally justifiable standpoint from which one can know the real world. The word truth, he insists, has no significant meaning. Traditional distinctions between true and false must be abandoned. In their place, we can only think and speak in terms of webs of language that display greater or lesser degrees of smoothness and homogeneity. For Rorty, every assertion of truth is only provisional, at its very core, a form of make-believe, because language itself is merely a product of human society. Our words refer to nothing, except insofar as they interpret our experience. Accordingly, Rorty rejected any and all efforts to render reality as meaningful through any means other than that of embracing it as a linguistically constructed, self-referential human social reality. This very argument, however, also deprived Rorty of any rational basis to support his or anyone else's defense of any social structure or view of reality, however compelling or desirable. Indeed, those who embrace such a view consistently cannot even investigate the historical conditions that established the social structures they desire. In The Future of Religion, Rorty acknowledged this profound intellectual disability, conceding, "It may be just an historical."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.